So let's begin with ringing the bell three times. And we'll let that sound be a reminder to us to come into this room, come into our bodies and everything that we're experiencing in this moment, not driving things away, but really embracing and watching curiously everything that is occurring, and to call us together into our practice. Reminding us that we can take refuge in the Buddha, the Dharma, and the Sangha. So the Buddha being the model for our exploration. The Dharma being the teachings that we can explore. And the Sangha being this community that supports that exploration. Dusum Sanghye Guru Rinpoche Nundru Kunda Deyvarchen Poja Barche Kunzel Dudru Drakpotel Solwa Depso Jinji Lab Nangjang Wei Bache Jiwadang Sampanji Drupal Jinji Lob. Precious guide, one with the Buddhas of all three times, blissful presence and source of all spiritual accomplishments, fierce destroyer of illusion who dispels every obstruction, we pray to you for blessing, inspiration, and realization. Please remove all outer, inner, and secret obstacles and spontaneously fulfill our aspirations. In Buddha, Dharma, and Sangha, we go for refuge until fully awakened through the power of generosity, ethics, patience, enthusiastic effort, concentration, and wisdom. For the sake of all beings, may we realize and demonstrate our innate goodness. In Buddha, Dharma, and Sangha, we go for refuge until fully awakened. Through the power of generosity, ethics, patience, enthusiastic effort, concentration, and wisdom. For the sake of all beings, may we realize and demonstrate our innate goodness. In Buddha, Dharma, and Sangha, we go for refuge until fully awakened. Through the power of generosity, ethics, patience, enthusiastic effort, concentration, and wisdom. For the sake of all beings, may we realize and demonstrate our innate goodness. So as we begin this morning, we'll chant a little bit. And chanting, as another reminder, is not about singing, it's not about praying, it's not about really anything, but allowing us to find focus in the exploration of making sound and vibration with our bodies. Let it be your exploration to feel what it feels like, experience what it is, to make sound and vibration as well as receive sound and vibration. So let that be your focus. we'll keep our chant simple to Lama Cheno, which means calling in the Lama, or better yet, awakening the teacher, calling in our own inner teacher. Lama Cheno, 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 Lama. Find yourself aware in your seat. Breathe, relax. Center, smile. Focus on being here right now. No need to go anywhere else. No need to think about the past. No need to think about the future. Simply be pleasant, present right now. Breathing into your low belly. Allowing your body not to be too tight, not too loose. focusing everything into this moment and the awareness, the panoramic awareness of everything that's going on, sight and sound, taste, touch, smell, naturally arising thoughts, connected emotions, simply be curiously aware of everything that's occurring, not trying to drive it away nor cling to it. Just sitting and breathing and being. Enjoying the three naturals, natural body, natural breath and energy, natural heart mind, open, awake, and aware. So we're just sitting, simply perceiving and experiencing, allowing and releasing. Savoring the natural state just as it is. Alpha Samaya Manupalaya Vajra Sattva Tenopa Tishta Drito Mevava Suto Kayo Mevava Supo Kayo Mevava Anuratha Mevava Sarva Siddhi Me Prayasa Sarva Karma Sutsame Sitsam Shreyam Guru Baha Baha Ho Bhagavan Sarva Tata Kapta Vajra Mame Mutsa Vajri Bhavam Mahasamaya Sattva Om Vajra Sattva Samaya Manupalaya Vajra Sattva Tenopa Tishta Drido Mebhava Suto Kayo Mebhava Supo Kayo Mebhava Anuraktu Mebhava Sarva Siddhi Me Prayatsa Sarva Karma Sutsam Me Sitsam Shreyam Guru Aha Aha Ho Bhagavan Sarva Tata Gata Vajra Mame Mutsa Vajri Bhava Mahasamaya Sattva Om Vajra Sattva Samaya Manupalaya Vajra Sattva Tenopa Ishta Drito Mevava Sukhukayo Mevava Sukhukayo Mevava Anuraktu Mevava Sarva Siddhi Mevrayata Sarva Karma Sutsame Sitam Shreyam Guru Ha 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 Ho Bhagavan Sarva Dasa Gata Vajra Mame Mutsa Vajri Bhava Mahasamaya Sattva
everyday being. So as some of you know, I used to travel a lot, 4 flights a week for 7 years. So a lot of frequent flyer miles and a lot of airplane experiences. I just kind of want to take you on a little exploration of just a sort of a fake flight scenario, just so we can kind of pluck apart some of what our responses are and what we do in this practice. So imagine that you just boarded a plane and you just found your seat, and it's your average, typical, everyday seat, maybe the one you even chose. You like the aisle seat, you like the window, whatever it is. And you notice a sound, sort of soothing, you know, that motor running sort of drone of a sound, and you think, oh, that's a sound, that's good, I like that. And then they close the plane up and get on the taxiway and take off, and, you know, go through all the steps and show us how to fasten the seat belts and do all the things, and you think, okay, this is a typical flight, and you notice that sound is still there and seems a kind of soothing, and you relax in and maybe open your book or your magazine, and then that sound changes and it becomes high-pitched and a little bit unusual. Look around and no one else seems to hear it or be responding to it, but it seems alarming to you. It's increasingly high-pitched, and what is it? What is that sound? I can't really figure out what that sound is, but it's not ceasing and it's not going away. So imagine what you might think. Shout out some things if you want to participate. I'm all for that today. You feeling anxiety?
Waiting.
A little what?
Waiting for something to happen.
Waiting for something to happen. Maybe a window's going to blow out. Holy crap.
Yeah.
But no one else seems to be responding. The flight attendant is having a conversation with a couple of passengers about cheese and mayonnaise and seems to not notice the sound. But it's persistent for you. And you hear it. And you're looking around for someone else to hear it as well. Are you alarmed? Is anybody else alarmed? I'm alarmed. So imagine I can't get away from that sound. It may or may not be a threat. My body, my mind is trying to discern if it's a threat, right? Follow me so far? I'm feeling anxious, maybe a little bit frightful, maybe I don't like flying. Definitely don't like the noise. The old noise I liked. So if it changed and it went back to the old noise, I'd be okay, right?
Right.
But it's not. And it's persistent. And there's still 2 hours left of this flight. And it doesn't seem to be going away. So in our unconscious body, we can lock into that fear and maybe try to get other people. Do you hear that? Do you hear what's going on? What's wrong? And you press the button. Boom, boom. Hey, mayonnaise lady. There's a sound. Do you hear the sound? Does anybody hear the sound? Should we be scared? Is there something going on? No, nobody else hears the sound. Just me, but I hear it. And it's driving me nuts at this point. Is a window going to blow out? Is that an engine that's failing? Is there air leaking out of this thing? And I have 2 hours left to this. I'm going to go crazy. So in our habitual reactive mind, all of those things are relevant. That fear, the anxiety, the like and dislike. I like the old sound. I don't like this sound very much. I want it to go away. I can't get away from it because I'm trapped on this plane. Maybe you tried to get up and go to the bathroom and see if maybe it would go away back there and it didn't. It's following me everywhere. I can't get away from it. Persistence, annoyance, fear. All of those things are boiling up in me, and I'm starting to react, and I'm starting to freak out. I don't have a pill with me. I don't have noise-canceling earphones, and no one else seems to hear this. What the hell is going on? And we start whipping ourselves into the emotional reaction. Unconsciously, mind you, this is not to be judged. But that's our natural reaction as we start reacting to that situation. On the other hand, we have the opportunity through a point of awareness that we can explore the experience of the unpleasant sound and the unpleasant feelings, the emotional reactions, the fear. I can see, oh, I'm fearful. Doesn't necessarily make the fear go away, but it maybe lessens the response to it, the unconscious response. When we start paying attention, okay, I'm fearful. Fearful something's going on. I feel trapped. No one else seems to hear it. Could be a threat, might not be. But I have 2 hours of this to get through. So how could you do that? What do you do? Alert someone and then you go back to an airport, right? could be that. And it could just be one of those airplane sounds that we don't understand. What could you do? I'm going to ask you.
Ask for a flight attendant to notify the pilot.
And what if it's nothing? But that sound is still there. Pass. Nobody else hears it.
I would just inquire for them to ask.
Okay, so.
Like, the pitch changed. It was this during most of the flight.
But where is your, and where I'm going with this is, where is your response? And remember, this is fictional. So, plane's not going down. But it's more about the reactivity that I want you to focus on. And what can I do to lessen what I'm finding in this reactivity, in this experience? What can I do to get myself through this unpleasant, trapped experience? And it could be a crying baby that's behind you and not just a high-pitched sound. It might just be something annoying. It could be loud people that are having a conversation about mayonnaise and cheese for hours. You could go back and accost them and say, shut them up. Or you can look at your own reactivity and response. Yeah?
I would see if, like, someone that was sitting next to you maybe had an extra pair of headphones or something. Or
so you can distract yourself from
it. Yeah, try to get rid of that.
Distract yourself from it, yeah. That's a pitfall, actually. That's a hurdle. So, like, when we turn to the things that distract us from our discomfort, it's kind of just as bad. So now I'm clinging to the thing that's distracting me, and I'm finding the respite in the noise-canceling headphones. And looking away from what is agitating or annoying me. Sometimes you just can't get away from it. So what do you do when you just can't get away from it?
Turn into it.
And tell me what that means.
What's that?
Tell me what that means. Turn into it.
Paying very close attention to it.
Watching it.
Like a
curiously watch it, yeah.
I sometimes ask myself questions like, why am I having this reaction?
Yes.
Why is it so bad?
Explore it curiously. Where do I feel this? Like the sensation of experiencing this thing. Where do I feel it in my body? Understanding that there's a visceral reaction to fear and annoyance and agitation and whatever that discomfort is, that there's a physical beingness that goes on with that, as well as all the mental reactions. And where I'm trying to get you to go is between the unconscious response and getting stuck in that, oh, this horrible thing that just won't cease. And where I can turn into it and see it for what it is. It's a noise that's making me uncomfortable. I'm finding a sensation of dislike that's associated with it. I would like for it to go away, and it's not. The awareness of it changes the reaction to it. And then we start to act in a little bit more wise fashion. It's still there. It's still persistent. I'm still experiencing it. It doesn't just evaporate. But our response and reaction can be different to it when we lean into it and pay attention to it and not try to get away from it, distract ourselves from it, change it, make it go away. Like grief and sorrow and despair. That those things can be so persistent and we can't get away from them so easily. When we're grieving, we can distract ourselves for a little while and maybe, you know, watch a show on Netflix or take a nap, and it's not so persistent. And then when we back from that, it's still there. It's still persistent. It's still prevalent. And what I'm saying is some of these tools, just awakened awareness, can get us through those moments of I can't get away from it, and it's completely unpleasant. And we know that we will get out of the other end because everything is impermanent. Terrible experiences and great experiences alike. Both impermanent. You see them for what they are, not what they ain't, as Lama Suryadas says. So in this exploration, as we sit and meditate, it's small exercises like this that we can start to pull apart the unpleasantness of sitting quietly, the pleasantness of sitting quietly, knowing both that are both are an experience and both are impermanent, and both teach us something if we are awake and aware for them. So as always, we open this up satsang style. So if you have questions, thoughts, troubles, throw it out. It's your turn.
Well, I have to say, I just kind of made a connection. Because I have experienced that sort of thing before, and I don't like finding it. But when I do it, I'm like, I sort of have a conversation. But the connection I made was, it's ironic because what I do is I forfeit my control. I mean, I don't have control. I've made the decision to be there. So the irony of it is that I kind of always go through my life wanting to fix it, and I can't fix it. So, you know, the connection for me here is there are moments in my life where I'm fine with not being able to fix it. You know, just live it, whatever it is, at the time, uncomfortable as it may be. So that was an interesting sort of revelation just a second ago. But we all live ironies anyway, so
right.
It's kind of nice.
It's a great lesson, though. And, you know, maybe the other lesson in that to explore is I know that there are moments that I want to control things. A little bit OCD here. I like to control things. I readjust things constantly. The thing that changes it is when I'm aware of it. And I giggle at it a lot. Because I'm like, oh, I'm readjusting that thing. I'm trying to control a thing that's uncontrollable. And I can find maybe a little bit of levity in that instead of a desperate determination that I must control things. Yeah.
I recently was reading a bunch of Buddhist books on interest, and one of the ones that I feel like applies to this is relax. Nothing is in control.
Right. Right.
It kind of occurred to me while you were talking about the taking things apart and turning into it and that kind of thing, that there's a lot about Buddhism that kind of mirrors the scientific method, you know, like rules of physics. And
right.
Observing something changes that which is observed.
Right.
And I think that's kind of interesting that you can almost apply a scientific, any kind of reaction you're having, you can apply a scientific method to it. Or why is this happening? Why am I having this reaction of what is going on here? And just kind of detach and look at it like it's a lab experiment rather than an emotional reaction that you're having.
See it. See it as it is. See it as the emotional reaction. Oh, I'm having an emotional reaction to a thing that just happened. It doesn't necessarily make it go away, but maybe the next action a little bit
stick to figure out what's going on.
Keep poking with a stick. That is that. Does that make sense? Does that feel practical to everybody? Because there's always those things that we just simply can't get away from. There's tons of stuff that we can try to do to distract ourselves. And I'm not saying not to do things that distract you. What I'm saying is that there's a difference in distracting yourself unconsciously and distracting yourself consciously. If you want to put the noise-canceling headphones on or read a book to kind of escape, know that's what you're doing. There's so much more power in that, so much more wisdom in doing that. I'm just going to take a load off. Maybe just take a break from trying to fix everything or control everything or worry about everything. But I can just rest, say rest in the natural state or whatever state you think you're in. So sit in that. Sit in the state that you are in. If you're sitting in grief, you can be aware that you're sitting in grief. If you're sitting in joy, or neutrality, we can be aware and awake that that is what is occurring as well. That is continually the exercise, coming back to our awakened awareness of whatever situation we're in. And it's not perfect. We have habitual responses because that's what happens. That's what we were trained to do. If we put our hand on the hot stove, we pull it away. Trained reaction. Some of those are good, like the hot stove. Some, when they are unconscious, most when they are unconscious, they are not delivered with wisdom. And they will lead to the next thing, the next thing, the next thing that we're doing to just unconsciously distract ourselves from that which we do not like. Or the discomfort of the idea that we will lose the thing that we do like. Yeah. More thoughts? Questions? Troubles? I'm here for a while. Good week this week? Yeah. Neutral? Bad?
I think there's some planets in retrograde.
Might be a planet. There's always planets in retrograde.
Yeah.
I'm not even sure what that means, but it's a thing that we like to say when things are off.
Yeah.
So they usually are. Torture you if there's not more questions or thoughts. There's coffee and our emergency package of fudge stripe cookies, which we bring out when Jeanette's not here and bring cupcakes. So we'll close everything. And remember, we always close with our bodhicitta dedication. The bodhicitta dedication is that reminder to us that all of this exploration and the wisdom that comes from it, the merit that we achieve from it, that we dedicate that to all beings. Everyone can have that peace, rest, and understanding, whatever they are doing. It simply takes awareness. May the pure, brilliant sun of bodhicitta dawn in each and every heart and mind, dispelling the darkness of suffering and confusion unstoppably until all are illumined and awakened. May the pure, brilliant sun of bodhicitta dawn in each and every heart and mind, dispelling the darkness of suffering and confusion unstoppably until all are illumined and awakened. May the pure, brilliant sun of bodhicitta dawn in each and every heart and mind, dispelling the darkness of suffering and confusion, unstoppably until all are illumined and awakened. Body, speech, and mind directed toward awakening for the benefit of all beings without exception.
Oh,